Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We ended up in the previous segment trying to reflect on one key verse or ayah in the Quran that is in chapter 49 al-Hujurat, ayah number 13. And basically, we're trying to show that beyond brotherhood of faith, which is also mentioned in that very surah or chapter, the Quran addresses the brotherhood of all humankind. Because when the Quran says that we are all created from the same pair of parents, husband and wife, or if it translates like men and women or male and female, the fact that Allah made us into nations and tribes is not that one tribe or group claims superiority over the other or accept inferiority to other for that matter. Because the Quran says ta'arafu, this is like mutual attempt on all to get to know and recognize one another, meaning to accept diversity within the basic unity of human beings as one broader family. But before I quote other verses in the Quran, may I just take a moment to reflect on the way the Quran addresses people that was mentioned casually in the previous segment. You see, if one reads the Quran, you find that there are two major types of addresses when God speaks in the Quran in two ways. Many verses in the Quran begin, for example, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, which translates, O believers. And of course, in that context, it speaks believers in Islam. But does that mean that some aspects of the Quran is inapplicable to others in terms of treatment? That's an interesting question, isn't it? But then you find other verses in the Quran that begins with Ya ayyuha an-nas, which means, O humankind, not only Muslim, all of you. Or a similar expression like Ya bani Adam, O children of Adam. Why is that difference? If one were to look carefully into the Quran, you find that the basic nature of verses that addresses believers are the verses that deal with their duties as Muslims having accepted Islam. I.e., when you read in the Quran, for example, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykum as-siyam. O believers, fasting has been prescribed upon you, referring to the fasting of the month of Ramadan. Why it addresses Muslim alone? Because this is their particular religious duty as Muslims. And it doesn't make any sense to require other people who have not accepted Islam yet to observe the specific fasting in Ramadan. Maybe other communities of faith have their own fasting as the Quran alludes. But when the Quran speaks about the duties of a Muslim, fasting, the five daily prayers, zakah, pilgrimage, and all other duties, it addresses Muslims because, again, it would be an imposition to address people who have not accepted Islam to abide by the acts of worship required by a Muslim. What's the difference here between believers, all believers, and all humankind? Very interesting one. If you go in the Quran and look at the verses that begin with O humankind or O children of Adam, you find that the basic orientation of these verses are beyond Muslims, beyond the acts of worship or obligations of Muslims having chosen to be Muslims. It deals with universalistic concepts, and I'll give you more than one example, God willing. The first example is what was recited when the Quran speaks about unity of human being being created, nations and tribes on equal footing. It didn't say, O Muslims. Because if it says, O Muslims or O believers, that means there would be equality only between Muslims, but you can discriminate against others. No, you can't. So that precludes that this is an address to Muslim alone. It is the entitlement of the entire human family. That was one. A second sample also from the Quran is found in the very first verse in chapter 4, An-Nisa, the fourth chapter in the Quran. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَّفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. What does it mean? The address here is different. Not all believers. All humankind. We means God created you from a single soul. And of it, which also could mean not of it physically, but of it in terms of the same nature, the same spirituality, the same worth. And of it, he created its mate or a spouse. And from both of them, that has been husband and wife in that case, or male and female, he scattered multitudes of men and women. Why does it begin with all people or humankind, not all believers? To remind us again that brotherhood of faith is a subset in a broader overarching brotherhood of the entire human race. People talk about white race and black race and yellow race. For a Muslim, there's only one race, human race. Human race. All are united in that relationship. Likewise, if we check, for example, chapter 30 in the Quran, Ar-Rum, where in verse 22, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِلْعَالِمِينَ. Of the signs of Allah, meaning the signs of His mercy and wisdom, is the creation of heavens and earth, and the diversity of your languages and your complexion. You're not addressing Muslims alone. It addresses all humankind. When the Quran, for example, in Surah Al-Isra, Surah number 17, verse number 70, when it speaks about the dignity of the human, it does not say dignity of the believer. There are verses, of course, talking about dignity of believers, especially in the hereafter. But in that particular verse, actually, it says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. Allah says, indeed, we honored or dignified the children of Adam. It didn't say only the Muslims, others are not entitled to human dignity. No. By virtue of being a human being, Muslim or a person of other faith community, or no faith in the traditional way that faith is defined, believer in God, defiant of God, obedient to God, in all cases, you are still a human being and you are entitled for that minimum human dignity, to be treated with dignity. But of course, we cannot insist on that if we are not respecting the dignity of others. So you don't say, don't arrest me because I stole, because you're trespassing against my human dignity. So it is reciprocal. But the issue here again is that the address is to the entire man. This is a very interesting way if one were to analyze the verses addressing believers and the verses addressing all humanity that deal with this universal concept. But that's not the only evidence. The basic rule in relating to peacefully coexisting other human beings, whether they believe in Islam or not, whether they believe in God even in the first place or not, is found very clearly in a verse that is seldom quoted or referred to, especially by those who misinterpret the Quran and try to allude somehow that the Quran teaches violence and disrespect of the rights of others. They forget that there are some verses that deal, yes, with conflict situation, with legitimate self-defense, with resistance to oppression. But these are the exception, not the rule, as some people mistakenly think. That the basic rule in relationship is that of peaceful coexistence. Let me give you the verse in question. Actually, there are two verses, but the second one actually reinforces the first one, so I'll just, for the sake of time, focus on the first verse. This is verse 8 in Surah 60. And let's read it.
لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم إن الله يحب المقسطين.
In the free translation, Allah does not restrain you or forbid you, O Muslims, with respect to those who refrain from fighting against you because of your faith, or drive you out of your homes, that you should deal with them in kindness and justice. For indeed, Allah or God loves those who are just. There is a basic contract in that verse. What do Muslims require of others, or are supposed to require of others? And how does that fare with the requirements of others of them? The Quran is very clear. Don't fight me because of my faith. Now, is that a capricious demand? Or is it the entitlement of every human being that you should never fight someone because he happens to believe in something different from you? Nothing in excess. Secondly, don't drive me out of my home. That is a reference to what? Oppression. Because the worst form of oppression is to drive me out of my home, turn me into a refugee, take my rights away from me. Is that the entitlement of Muslims again? Is it capricious? Or is it the entitlement of each and every human being regardless? Very simple demands. Basic human rights, not Muslim rights. What is in return for that? For people even who are not accepting Islam, rejecting the message of Islam, which is their right, after all. That you should deal them in kindness and justice. You don't oppress them, you don't treat them unjustly, in terms of all of their rights, education, employment, proper treatment, equality before the law, equality before the courts of law, no prejudice, no discrimination. That's what the Quran says. That's what justice means. And we haven't come yet even to analysis of the term justice, where the term come from, and how does the Quranic term adl even is broader than justice in English. And then it says the second entitlement for those who peacefully coexist, that to treat them in kindness. What kind of kindness? Is the term in the Quran exactly means kindness or something bigger than that even? Let's pick up with that after the break, inshallah, God willing. Assalamu alaikum and peace be with you. Let me make a comment just to catch up with the notion of justice. The word that appears in the Quran is coming from qist, tuqsitu. Many translated to be just to them. However, we find some linguists and scholars like the classical scholar Ibn al-Arabi. He says that to deal with them in qist is more than just adl or justice. Because basically justice means that you take your right no more and no less. Whereas Ibn al-Arabi said that the word qist actually means something beyond giving others their full rights, such as giving gifts in occasions, or softening hearts, or establishing good feeling. And that's why he said, تُعْطُوهُم مِّنْ أَمْوَالِكُمْ, not only giving them their full rights, but something even more for courteous and peaceful relationship between members of the same society. Likewise, there is a problem also with translating تَبَرُّهُم. Most translators say to deal with them kindly. That's good enough, I know. But the verse in the Quran speaks about something higher than kindness. Higher than kindness? What does that mean? The verse uses a term in treating others, tabarruhum, which come from the Arabic birr. And birr actually is the term that is used frequently in the Quran and also in the teaching of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to describe our obligations towards our parents. But isn't that kindness? No, that's not enough. Because our relationship with our parents begins with love, yes. It begins with kindness. But we are also obligated to treat our parents in love. Even if they adopt a different faith from ours, we don't love the rejection of faith, but we love them as individuals. After all, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, loved his uncle Abu Talib so dearly, not because Abu Talib rejected Islam. He loved him as a good person who supported him all the way since he was a child and also stood by him in the very difficult years of persecution of Muslims in Mecca. So relationship with parents involves kindness, it involves love, it involves respect as well. And if we look at the depth of the term used in the Quran, Allah could have chosen other words because these people are not Muslims anyway, so be just kind. No. He chose among all terminology that term that connotes kindness, love, and respect. We can elaborate on that in a different occasion, the difference between, you know, loving disobedience of Allah and loving a person and leaving the accountability of the person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the day of judgment. This verse is really most amazing in terms of its implication. It does not deal with the exception, it deals with the basic rules as more discerning scholars have been able to find out. This is the constitution of peaceful coexistence between Muslims and all other faith communities, implying, as indicated in the previous segment, that anything that deals in the Quran or Hadith that deals with legitimate self-defense or fighting against oppression, but again in a legitimate way, in an ethical manner, are the exception and not the ideal that Muslims should be striving at. What they should be striving at is the norm of peaceful coexistence. Now, is that the only verse in the Quran that deal with this? Actually, it is not. The Quran is totally and completely consistent, A to Z, if we approach it in the proper methodology and proper way. The only conditions under which Muslims are allowed to fight against others, I'm talking about wars, are two. Legitimate self-defense and against oppression. That sounds very much like the verse that we quoted, like chapter 60, verse 8. Exactly. That's in 60, but in chapter 2 in the Quran, even the one that gave Muslims the right to defend themselves, it says, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ. It says fight, so there's permission. Fight in the way of God. Way of God means within the limits of Allah, what Allah has prescribed as justifying carrying arms and using force as a last resort. As a last resort, I emphasize, because justice could not be achieved through peaceful means after lots of patience. Fight in the way of Allah. Those who fight against you, what does it mean? Against those who initiate aggression against you. Is that something that a Muslim should feel ashamed of? Isn't that part of international law? Isn't that something inherent in human nature to defend yourself when you're unprovokedly attacked? Isn't that enshrined or not in the Charter of the United Nations, the right of legitimate self-defense, when this is the only way to use force? Muslims should not be ashamed that the Quran does allow positive peace, not just peace in a sense of absence of war, but positive peace, but also trying to prevent those who tamper with peace, take away the peace of others, that they have to be stopped if no other means can stop them. The second condition, you read in the same section, from verse 190 to 193, it says fight until there is no more oppression. Until there is no more oppression. Fully and completely consistent with the two conditions that appear in chapter 60, that proves again, that proved the basic point, that is, the peaceful coexistence is the rule. Other than that, if there is aggression or oppression, then the exception here would be to use the force to defend yourself in an ethical manner that we have no time to detail on that. Maybe that, inshallah, God willing, will be covered in another session dealing with what the word jihad really means. How about some of the verses that deal with this in the Quran? What I was trying to conclude then from this is that relationship with humans, or peaceful relationship with humans, stemming from inner peace and above all peace with the Creator, does include not only Muslims, but all people of other faith communities, all human beings as such, who refrain from tampering with the legitimate rights of Muslims. That brings us to other points that we perhaps can mention in brief, because both actually could be a good topic for environment, Islam and the environment. But based on the primary sources of Islam, the Quran and the teaching of his Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, we find that the peaceful relationship goes beyond even relationship with humans, relationship with animals. There are numerous places, I mentioned them quickly, numerous places in the Quran and the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that speak about being kind to animals, forbidding torturing animals, forbidding, for example, mutilation of animals, except that when you have animals permissible for food, for the sake of mutilation in itself, it is not permissible. There are traditions that shows that a person who did wrong, a man or woman, there are different versions, were forgiven by Allah on account of being kind to a thirsty dog. In another tradition, a woman is to be punished in the hellfire because of cruelty to a cat. So relationship with animals is also emphasized in the Quran. In fact, the Quran draws attention beyond the functionality of animals to their beauty, describing the beauty of horses, the beauty of other creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to appreciate what Allah created in this universe. Even in the war situation, Islam forbade killing animals except as needed for food. But otherwise, you don't commit these acts even against animals. The Quran also, and the teaching of the Prophet, peace be upon him, speak about kindness even to, you can call it kindness also, or appreciation of vegetation. It talk also about functionality, like eating the fruits and vegetables. It talk about the beauty when they bloom, so that you can appreciate. Again, in war situation, Muslims are not allowed to cut a fruitful tree if there is no strategic or defensive necessity for that. Appreciation of the creation of Allah. And finally, relationship even with inanimate objects, with the resources that Allah created. Again, we find Islam teach wise use of resources, like water. I understand in many countries, it's a big problem of water, saving water, not wasting water, shortage of water. And there are many traditions that shows how the Prophet, peace be upon him, taught Muslim, even when they make ablution, washing, wudu, for the prayer, that they should not excessively waste or use water for that. So we conclude then that this is a beautiful definition, I believe, in Islam. If you talk about being at peace with Allah, with yourself, with all creation of Allah, humans, Muslims and others, animals, vegetation, ecology, all of that through submitting to Allah and be willing to accept His guidance in our lives. May Allah's peace and blessing be upon you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.